Hello everyone, welcome back to LEGO Star Wars, and yes, here we are in A New Hope. We're in the good movies now, which is nice. Just gonna slap Captain Antilope, whatever his name is. I love making up a fake name for a character in a thing, and then saying whatever his name is, acting like I don't know their name, so that I can be all hip and dismissive of the popular thing that I like. Although I gotta say, over the last several years, I've really come to not like Star Wars as much as I did when I was younger, just because of everything. Not the reasons that a lot of people say that Star Wars sucks now, but in a more general way, just kind of as part of the broad trend of everything sucking. Anyway, I didn't bother speeding up or cutting out any of this stud collecting, because I just thought we would slip into the mood here. So I am far less familiar with the second half of this game than I am the first one, as I've said before. I only ever owned, until fairly recently, or I guess a while ago at this point, but as a kid, I only owned LEGO Star Wars 1. And I had it for the PS2, and that one just had episodes 1 through 3, and apparently had several minor, but noticeable differences, not only stuff that you wouldn't find until the second one, like stormtrooper doors and shit like that, but also apparently, for no fucking reason, getting rid of the thing that makes playing as Yoda tolerable at all. Which was a very big bummer to find out, and I don't know how I didn't notice that the last time I played through this game, because I played through at least the prequel levels on stream like 2 or 3 years ago, and I don't remember that being a thing. But whatever. But yeah, the main difference in the LEGO Star Wars 2 levels, I guess I should call them the original trilogy levels, I think, on average, these levels seem to be longer, and a tad more involved sometimes as well, and they also have a lot more building shit. They started doing that a lot more in subsequent, LEGO games after that. The first, Star Wars one, for whatever reason, I guess they realized that people enjoy, building stuff in a LEGO game, even though, of course, you're just holding a button while you watch a person do a little jig, which I just imitated, even though you can't see me. And this is really a dick move, just spitting out all of these studs so you can't get like half of them. They either need to not spread out so much or be on the screen longer, in my opinion. Once I know I've already said this, but I'm continually surprised by how much of a challenge getting all of the studs is sometimes. When you're going out of your way to get as many of them as you can. Or maybe I'm just less patient as a young adult than I was when I was a child. Who knows? Also, at least with the ones in A New Hope, I don't really remember how it goes in the Empire Strikes Back or Return of the Jedi levels off the top of my head. But at least with A New Hope, I've also noticed, I don't know if the cutscenes are longer per se, but they are like more like the scenes that they are trying to show. and I think that has more to do with the difference between the prequels and the original trilogy than anything between the two games, because as I've said before, one of the main reasons that the prequels, even though I'm not a blind hater of it like a lot of people are, not to suggest that people who hate it are blind, but you know what I mean, I don't like viscerally hate them, I just think they're kind of shitty movies. But I can still find things to enjoy about them, and there are interesting things about them, and they're interesting as cultural products. That was a big, big load that just got dumped on me of studs. That was cool. You may not be able to notice it because it's sped up, but that guy in the other room, or I guess it's different guys, but they just keep getting continually blown apart by Darth Vader until you go in there, so your quest for studs actively, Princess Leia's quest for money to become a true Jedi actively raises the number of casualties to her friends by the Empire, so problematic princess. What was I saying? Oh yeah, because like I've said before, one of the main reasons I have a problem with the prequels is because just most of the scenes are bad. They don't feel like movie scenes. They're just kind of people walking and talking over static backgrounds and just the screen being cluttered with bullshit all the time during the action scenes. Whereas Star Wars, the original trilogy, kind of feels like movies, and the scenes feel like scenes where there's like a point to them, like there's a, you know, there's like a little conflict within each scene where there's like a character dynamic going on and information being communicated, and I don't know. And also, I guess the scenes are just more, for lack of a better term, iconic in the first film, by which I mean episode 4. By the way, one of my favorite things about prequel to talk about with prequel defenders and people who love the prequels, and more importantly, not just people who defend the prequels, which I don't have a problem with, but specifically say that they're the best trilogy and that they're better than the original trilogy, which you can like them better, but I don't know. Saying that they're better movies, I'm not saying there's a right or wrong answer to that. I'm just saying, I think you're wrong, so, and you can care about that as little or as much as you want. I wouldn't care about it at all if I were you, but anyway. Sorry, I had to drink water. It's important to stay hydrated. I like dumping these dudes in the ditch. Alliteration. But anyway, yeah, one of the things that I like to, that is funny when it's brought up with people who say that about the prequels, is A lot of them bring up, like, you know, when I say that just only the original trilogy really should have come out, like, it would be better if it was just those three movies, or even just the first Star Wars movie, and it, like, did shitty, then I feel like we would have a little bit healthier, that much healthier of a universe, I think, and of a pop culture. It would be just that much less annoying. One less franchise for people to be annoying about. I like the guy in the swimsuit. It's pretty funny. Recurring motif in this game, if I remember correctly, in the second half. But they always talk about how, well, you need to make the prequels because it's episode 4. And more importantly, that it's all part of, that it's very important that George Lucas's vision, you know, that George Lucas says this, or at least used to say it, that the prequels, that he always imagined that it would be, that of what 1 through 3 would be. And first of all, it's like, well, yeah, I guess you can kind of imagine what 1 through 3 would be if the idea is that it just brings you up to episode 4, like, You know where everyone's gonna end up if that's the story you're gonna go with, but more importantly, no, it wasn't. At the time of the first Star Wars movie, episode 4 was just a random number, because it's a homage to Flash Gordon, which and the adventure serials that George Lucas grew up with in the 30s. Or, I guess, I don't even know if he was alive in the 30s, but they're from the 30s, and he grew up watching them, and Star Wars is an homage to them, as is Indiana Jones, by his own fucking admission, and by having eyes and knowing what those movies are. And in the Flash Gordon serials, every little film would have a random episode number kind of thing, and it would have an opening crawl where it would be like, we now join our heroes in the Florkin Desert on the planet Cum, and you know, there's a little alien dude, and the idea being the suggestion of a larger world and conflict outside of just what you're seeing. And Star Wars was a 70s-ified kind of riff on that, among other things. And that's what's cool about it. It was never, at least to me, like, On a film level, I never really gave a shit. Like, I don't know, I feel like you get a lot of interesting stuff about Anakin's life from watching the Star Wars movies, like the original ones, because they talk about it. Like, I don't know, after the three movies, it's like, I don't, if you're gonna make me watch 6 hours of movies, it better be a fucking incredible story of this kid. And it isn't, so it makes me feel like it's stupid. I don't know, am I making sense? It's not a big deal. I'm not saying that it's a problem. I don't know, never mind. Rebel friend. I like that guy. He's the unsung hero. He's the unhung hero. Has anyone ever heard of that movie? I think I'm one of like 10 people that's seen that movie. It's a really terrible documentary. I saw it on Netflix. I don't know if it's still on Netflix. But it's by a guy, and he has a small penis, which you never see in the film, which I think is kind of stupid. If you're going to make a whole documentary about how you're self-conscious about the fact that your dick is small, like, okay, well, let's see it. How bad is it? Like, I need to know if you're overreacting. Because you could probably, odds are he has a completely normal penis. But, anyway, it's this guy, and he proposes to his girlfriend in public at like a sports game, and she says no. And I don't know if it's just because he has a small penis, but that is part of it. And so then he makes a whole film about him either trying to figure out either how to make his dick bigger, or how to deal with having a small dick. So, like, he interviews people who have, like, micro penises or, like, inverted penises, and they're like, it's not so bad if you just never have sex, or the sex you have is bad and you're fine with that. And he's like, well, that sucks. I wouldn't want to be you. And then, he goes to a Chinese clinic who does a procedure where they take skin or tissue or whatever from somewhere else on your body, and they put it in your wiener to make it longer. And he's like, I'm gonna fucking do it. I'm gonna do it now. And it's like, before he's gonna do it, and they let him watch them doing it to a guy, which, why would you do with any surgery, even when you need, like, and I don't want to see what you're gonna do, of course not, like, what the fuck, but, like, that's gonna turn you off from anything like that, I would think. Anyway, he watches a guy get his dick cut open. Oh, why did I not cut this out? Well, that's very unprofessional of me. It's only a few seconds, though. I think I was just making sure that my, recording was working okay. Well, whatever, we got through it. Anyway, I guess I just didn't notice it while I was editing. To be fair, this is a very long, level. I actually don't finish it in this episode. It's gonna be the first probably 5 or 10 minutes of the next one. It's very long, and it was even longer with all of the, stud collecting, which you have to do a lot of. And it's also one of those fun levels where you're getting attacked every 3 seconds. So if you want to do anything, you have to be able to do it while getting shot. And it's really helpful if you have a second player who's a human being who can help you, but when it's a computer, it doesn't work as well. And not to get away from my, about talking about the penis documentary, but, I realized, or was told recently by Custard and, I guess just Custard, that, the PC version of this game and other LEGO games doesn't have online multiplayer, it only has local, and so I would need to get this on, like, Parsec or something, if I wanted to play through it with people. But that sucks, because the whole point of this would be to play it on the file that I have, unless you can do that in part, unless that's what that would be. But it would be, I guess I could just play through this again with people, but I'd still have to go through it more than once, because it's not just the only having one player thing is of why I would go through it again. It's also because there's a bunch of extra stuff that you can't do until you've unlocked free play on it. So, I don't know what to do about any of that. But anyway, so he sees the thing, and long story short, he decides that he doesn't want to do that, and he's like, well, shit, I've kind of exhausted my options on how to get my dick big, and I still feel shitty about it. So instead, he does an interview, which is hilarious, with a guy who, I'm not gonna be so bold as to claim that he has the biggest penis ever, because, like, who could know such a truth? He talks to a guy with a really big dick, like, you see it in his pants going all the way down to his leg when it's flaccid, and when it's hard, it's, like, ridiculous. And he's like, so what's it like having a huge dick? And he's like, honestly, not that great. It makes a lot of people uncomfortable. It limits clothing choices. And you know, when you're doing stuff with people, not much of it gets to be part of it because it's really big. And so it just, the documentary just ends with the guy going like, well, maybe it's okay to have a small penis after all. And it's like, great, you just spend 90 minutes of me watching you come to terms with having a small dick, and nothing more interesting about that at all. Or, like, you didn't even get the procedure, you didn't even show me your dick. Like, huge ripoff of a movie, huge fucking waste of time, 0 out of 10. worst dick movie I've ever seen. I watched this like 5 years ago, by the way. This is not even a recent thing, and I remember all of this because it fucking sucked. But yeah, wasn't planning on talking about that, but it's pretty cool. I just got done before recording this watching Kitchen Nightmares, which is an excellent show. Watching Gordon Ramsay get mad at everybody. It's really funny because there are like three types of restaurants on that show. Three types of problems that the restaurants have, usually. One is the people are just really stupid. Like, they're well-intentioned, and they hope that they're doing a good job, but most of them kind of know that they're not. But they literally just don't know how to do anything. And so he just has to come in and be like, okay, I'm going to teach you all how to cook and fucking serve tables. I'm just going to do Restaurant 101. You've been open for like 10 years and you're just now figuring this out. Whatever. Other ones are they don't have money. Which I guess actually kind of encompasses all of these. A lot of it comes down to money, unsurprisingly. A lot of the time, it's just like, we went into a bunch of debt opening the restaurant, and so we can't afford shit that doesn't come out of a can, so our food sucks, and no one comes here, so we don't have money, so we're even more in the red, and it's just a big problem. But so the two ways that that goes is either, is stuff like just, usually the food, when the food is bad, the guy is just like, well, I'm awesome. Like, I know how to fucking do this. Like, it's either the chef or the owner is, just not cooperative and, like, thinks he's big dog even though everything sucks. And even when things improve at the restaurant because of what Ramsay does, is still like, I thought the way I did it was fine, but, you know, it's good that people like how fucking Gordon Ramsay does it, I guess, if you think that's good. I'm glad to make money. or there's people who are the craziest ones are just the ones where the food is just rotten, where like they just have black food and they're like, this is how I've always stored my food. I am a restaurateur. I have worked in food and eaten food for 30 years and all of it comes from a can and looks like it will kill me. That's how it is, Gordon Ramsay. Don't look it up. Don't know how much you know about food, guy, but it's supposed to look like that. And those are the best ones, and where the people just seem fucking delusional. But you never know if that's actually how people are, because of course it's a reality show, so it's not real. And, you know, everything is very played up. One of the reasons I love that show so much is because of how much it plays up the reality TV aesthetic aspects of it, where it's so over the top in its editing with its music cues and its, the beeping, text on the corner saying what time it is at the beginning of every new, section. Like it's a spy movie or something. And, obviously, Gordon's, savage owns, of course, are, over the top, and it's everything you want. And, of course, Hotel Hell is an amazing, sister, program to that, which is similar. And, me and Liv have watched many episodes of both. And there's actually a place in Liv's hometown that was on Hotel Hell, or Kitchen Nightmares, one of the two. I think it's Hotel Hell, but it was, like, a restaurant with a hotel part to it. And yeah, Gordon Ramsay saved the day. Now it has new owners. Anyway, next time we're gonna finish up through the Jundland Wastes, which I managed to not talk about at all during this video. Isn't that fun? See you next time.